Next, we do not want to count how often a certain element is appearing in a stream, but how many distinct elements the stream contains. So this is again aiming at deriving a sketch, a synopsis that is containing this information and allows us to estimate this distinct value number. In distributed systems, it's also important that you can exchange data in a compact way. For instance, now if you're doing such a sketch, we will see, then you can create these sketches independently in different locations in your network and then exchange them to get an overall estimate. This is also like an important property of such algorithms. The next approach is called Flageolet-Martin sketch. This is an estimator for the number of distinct elements in a stream. What we do here is to create a bit vector, which then can be used to get an estimate for this number. Let me introduce this with a drawing instead of going through the slide first. So what we have is a multiset, which corresponds to the values of our attribute that we want to estimate. We want to estimate the number of distinct values this attribute takes on. Let's say we have values A, B, A, C, A, B, D, and so on. And what is the estimator doing? It is taking a hash function, h, and is applying h on these values. Hash of A, hash of B, hash of A again, hash of C, and so on. And is doing it for all of these values in this multiset. We will see in a minute why it doesn't matter if A happens multiple times, and hence the estimator will count distinct values and not the total number of occurrences. It is important that the hash function is creating hash values which are uniformly distributed. So if we have hash of A, we could for instance look like this, 1, 0, 1, 1. And here we have 0, 1, 1, 1. And here we have again, because it's A, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1. Here we might have 1, 1, 1, 0. And then also we have D. And this might have, 0, 0, 1, 1, something like this. So these are uniformly distributed, these values. So what do we do with these values? We create a vector, a bit vector B, and initially all of these bits here are set to 0. And now when we do the hashing here, or while we're doing the hashing, we look at these hash values, for instance here, 1011, and we look at the position of the least significant bit, which is set to 1. The least significant bit. So here it starts with least and the most significant bit. So the least significant bit here in our writing is on the right-hand side. And here, this one is the position of the least significant one bit. So this is the first bit at position 0, which is set to 1, right? Then we go to our bit vector and we will set here the position 0 accordingly to 1. Then we proceed, looking at the second hash here. This is for B, and we again see, by coincidence, that also here the bit at position 0 is set to 1. And then we go to our B vector here, but we see already it's already 1, so nothing changes. It remains 1. So we then go to our next hash. This is again the hash of A. And as you can see, we have again, obviously, the same position is the least significant one bit, and again nothing will happen because the entry is already set to 1 and B is a bit vector. So we continue, and now it's getting a bit more interesting. Here for the hash of C, we have the second bit set to 1 and the first bit here is 0, so we go one further in the search for the least significant one bit, and this is the position 1. So we go here and we set the 0 bit to 1. So, and now we have here hash of D. Again here, this is like the leftmost one bit is the bit at position 0, this is already set to 1, nothing happens, right? So you see why this is ignoring duplicate occurrences here for the case of A, as illustrated. And of course, same for B and so on would also happen if B, now we would hash again and we get the same bit vector and the same least significant bit. So okay, we understand why these duplicates are not counted. But why is this B vector now giving us a hint about the number of distinct values in our multiset? For this, I would like to ask the important question, how many times, assuming that we know that we have n distinct values in our set, how many times do you think this bit is set to 1? For how many of the distinct values in our multiset is this bit set to 1? Assuming that we know we have n distinct values. And we have to recall again that these hash functions are uniformly distributed. So for how many of these values is this bit set to 1? Well, for all, where the first bit here is a 1. It can either be a 1 or can be a 0, right? But for the case where it's 1, this bit is set to 1. For how many of these cases of n does it happen? Well, n divided by 2. For half of all numbers or all values, they will set the first bit here for the b vector to 1. Okay, this should make sense, right? Let's have a look at this bit here, the bit at position 2, or position 1, sorry, the second bit. We're counting from 0, right? So how many times is this set to 1? Well, for the ones that already set this bit to 1, they won't set this bit to 1 because they have already set this bit to 1. We're looking for the least significant bit. So this means that for the ones, for the numbers, for the A, B, C, D, they did not set the first bit here to 1, which are n divided by 2, half of them will have the least significant bit like this one here. So we have this here set to 1 by n divided by 4. Right? Again, assuming that the hashing is done uniformly. And we did not have the case in the data, but there could be also a 1 here, or 1 here, and a 1 here. And each of these ones have a certain expectation that this 1 exists, or is set to a certain by so and so many of the elements. And this rule here that we see, n divided by 2, n divided by 4, n divided by 8, and so on, continues. Up to a certain position where it's very unlikely that this bit will be set to 1. Because n divided by a certain value, n divided by 2 to the, let's say, power of t, is 0 or 1. So it's very unlikely, or smaller. So it's very unlikely that this bit is set to 1. So let's say we know the position of this bit, which is set to 1, and then only zeros continue. If we have this, then we can somehow estimate the number of distinct values, n. So we're searching for n. So what the algorithm is proposing then is to find this position where it's unlikely that the bit is set to 1 by looking for the leftmost 0 bit. In this case, it would be here. This is our leftmost 0 bit. The algorithm takes this position as the indication that n divided by 2 to the bit position is unlikely to be set by any of these A, B, C, D values. So this position we call t. In this case, t is 2. And then our estimator will be 2 to the 2 is 4. This is the expected number of distinct values in our multiset. And by luck, or because I made up the example, this also turns out to be the exact value. So again, we take a hash function, we apply the hash function on each of these values, a, b, c, d. The hash function is uniformly distributed, that means that half of these hash values will fall on the first position of the b vector, where the least significant bit is here at position 0, right? And here, and here, and here. N divided by 4 will be having the next significant bit, n divided by 8, and so on. And at some point, it will get more and more unlikely that this bit is set to 1, and the estimator takes the leftmost 0 as the indicator of the logarithm to base of 2 of the number of distinct elements. So in the end, in our example, this t is 2, so we have 2 to the 2 is 4 is our estimation. If you're looking at the paper and the forthcoming slides, you see that we don't take 2 to the 2 directly, but there is also some little approximation factor coming from the theory, but this is the intuition why the estimator works. So we have here this bit vector called b. We take a size which is sufficient. We do not know, of course, the real number of distinct elements n, but we will pick it in a conservative way. Let's say 32 bits or 64 bits, something that is sufficient. And then we apply the hash function on the individual stream elements, find the least significant 1 bit, and set the corresponding bit inside this b vector to 1. And then, as illustrated, we can look at the position of the leftmost 0 bit. We call that position t. And then we get an estimate for the count of the distinct elements as 2 to the t divided by phi, with parameter phi equals 0.7735. In this example here, for this b, we would get an estimate of 10.35. And if you're doing this, you will see this does not work very well. What you need to do in addition is a technique called stochastic averaging. Here you're doing, or you're applying this FM sketch, or you're creating multiple FM sketches, multiple B arrays for different hash functions, and you're computing the position T for each of these individual sketches, and then you compute the average T value, and then you're using this formula to get the estimator, and then you will see that this is, for reasonable numbers of sketches, working very well. Yeah, and the idea why this works, I have already mentioned. If you look at the leftmost entry in our b vector, so the first entry, we have already seen or discussed that this is approximately set n divided by 2 times, and then the next one is set n divided by 4 times, and so on. So in the middle, between the zeros and the ones, where you have a mix of 0 and 1s, this is roughly corresponding then to the logarithm to base 2 of n. N is what we want to compute. And then what the authors proposed is to use the leftmost 0 as the indicator. This is a rough idea, and then you had also this correction factor in, as we saw on the previous slide. If you have two FM sketches created for sets S and T, multisets of course, otherwise the counting of distinct elements is not so difficult, right? Then you obtain sketches BT and BS, and then the sketch that represents the set or the multiset union is simply given by doing a bitwise OR over these individual B vectors for the sketches.